Anyway, it's nice to be with you. Pastor Athel and Debbie are on their vacation, much needed break to celebrate their anniversary. So I hope they're having a really, really good time. So we pray for them and bless them. And he'll be back, of course, this coming week as we begin Passion Week, our Holy Week. This awesome time, one of my favorite times. So can I pray for you this morning as we begin our time together in the Word of God? So Lord, I want to pray for the church this morning that's right here in front of me. And Lord, I thank you for each and every one of them. I thank you, Lord, that we get to open your word this morning and hear from you. And Lord, teach us by your Holy Spirit, God. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your grace. And thank you that you see us and you love us. As the song we've been singing, Lord, we say, praise you, Lord. Hosanna to the highest. Thank you, God, for all that you're doing and all that you've done. We give you the praise, Lord, as a church. In your wonderful name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. When I moved back to the USA from being a missionary, it was 1998, moved actually here to Kansas City. And I'm not a huge football fan, but I do like to watch and have followed football. And of course, coming here to Kansas City, I had to tune into our Chiefs. And I remember watching some of the first games. Now, you have to understand, 1998, when I moved here, I hadn't seen American football for years. Because back then, there wasn't streaming video and services like we have now. So all of a sudden, I'm watching this game. And I remember seeing this, you know, it was a penalty, it was a flag, and I remember seeing a yellow line, the first down line, appear on the grass on the screen. And I'm looking at the screen, I'm going, that is so cool. How did they paint that yellow line really fast? Thank you. Somebody got my joke here. And I realized, it took me a few seconds, and I realized, oh, they were superimposing that onto the screen. I wasn't used to that. I was like, oh, new technology. Then I'd come back from before. I remember, you know, if it was a first down, the old school here, the guys would have to come out with the poles. You remember that? With a chain between, and they'd have to measure, and remember all those things they used to have to do. So now I'm watching this game going, this is really cool. And then I remember a wide receiver was supposed to get one of those touchdowns, you know, and he caught it, and he was right there on the edge, almost like me on the stage. Don't worry, I won't fall, I hope. And he caught it, and they weren't sure his feet were both in bounds. And so they had this cool new technology called instant replay. We don't think of it so much anymore because it's so standard. But the cool thing about it is they could take different camera angles and show exactly where his feet were and how he had caught the ball, and they could slow it down and see it from different angles. And that way, the referees could make the most perfect judgment or call according to that football play, because they could see it in different ways, in different angles, and know what was going on. I thought, that was pretty cool technology. I like that. I thought that was fun. Now, like I said, it seems so commonplace. But we're going to look at something this morning that, as you can see from the screen there, is a big deal. And it's Palm Sunday today. And, you know, I have to be honest, I've been in church long enough to where Palm Sunday was sort of just this blip on a radar. Couldn't really wait till I actually get to the real stuff, right? Easter, I don't know about you. At least Good Friday and Easter. Palm Sunday was kind of just the day the church would, you know, have kids come in with palm branches and they might preach on it or not. I didn't really get it, honestly. But somehow studying it this time, as we're going through the book of Mark as part of that 1KC series that Pastor Athel has been doing, we come to Mark 11. So if you've got your Bible, I want to invite you to turn to Mark chapter 11. And we're just going to read the first part of it. There's so much going on. This is called the Triumphal Entry. And as I'm going to propose to you, maybe it wasn't so triumphal after all. But at least in my Bible and probably yours, it's labeled as the Triumphant Entry. And why it's such a big deal as you're turning your Bible to Mark chapter 11 is all four Gospels record this story. Now, that may not strike you right away, but it's a big deal. Because up until this point, there's only one other story that all four Gospels capture, and that's the feeding of the 5,000. So like that multiple camera angle on a football field, we've got four Gospel writers describing this from different angles, describing this event, because even though we might pass it over in our church or not think so much of Palm Sunday, this is a big deal. And I hope by the end of the sermon you can see why this is such a big deal. So if you're looking at Mark chapter 11, we're going to at least read from Mark, and I'm going to relate a little bit to some of the other gospel writers. Mark chapter 11, verse 1. Now when they drew near to Jerusalem, to Bethpage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples, and he said to them, "Go into the village in front of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says, 'Why are you doing this?' say, 'The Lord has need of it, and he will send it back here immediately.' And they went away, and they found a colt tied to the front door outside of the street, and they untied it. And some of the ones standing there were saying, 'What are you doing, untying the colt?' And they said to them exactly what Jesus had said, and they let them go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. And many spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches, palm branches, this is where we get the name Palm Sunday, by the way, and that they'd cut from the field. And those went out before who were following him shouting, 'Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming of the kingdom of our father, David. Hosanna in the highest.' And he entered Jerusalem, and he went into the temple, and when he had looked around at everything, it was already late. And he went back out to Bethany with the 12. We're just going to pause there for a moment. There is so much just in this portion of Scripture. But I don't know about you, I'm a real visual learner, so I like to watch it. And of course, we can't actually see what really happened. But I'm going to show you this little clip from actually the version of John, where we're going to see just a little bit of a different angle.
The next day, the large crowd that had come to the Passover festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Praise God! God bless him who comes in the name of the Lord. God bless the King of Israel." Jesus found a donkey and rode on it, just as the scripture says, "Do not be afraid, city of Zion. Here comes your king, riding on a young donkey." His disciples did not understand this at the time, but when Jesus had been raised to glory, they remembered that the scripture said this about him, and that they had done this for him. The people who had been with Jesus when he called Lazarus out of the grave and raised him from death had reported what had happened. That was why the crowd met him, because they heard he had performed this miracle. The Pharisees then said to one another,
"You see, we are not succeeding at all. Look, the whole world is following him."
This is a big deal, you guys. And just even visually be able to see that, it probably doesn't even show it accurately, the numbers of people. You see, we just celebrated Passover, and for you guys who were able to be a part of Jeff's Seder last night, you know that yesterday was Passover. But back in Jesus' time, Passover was yet to come. It was actually the coming Friday. And we know this event probably took place on Sunday, or at least latest on Monday. How do we know that? Because John's gospel actually tells us that Jesus was already in Bethany. Go ahead and put the next one up, David. Bethany, if you look at this map, is outside of Jerusalem. Today, Jerusalem is so big, it's just kind of disappeared as a suburb. But back then, it was its own separate village. And you can see it way over there on the right-hand side. And if you follow that red Roman road, that would lead you to Bethpage, where they pick up this donkey, this colt. And then the red line goes kind of squiggly there because they're going down the Mount of Olives, across the Kidron Valley, and into the temple, which we just read. But I wanted you to just get a picture of this. Because John tells us that Jesus was already in Bethany. So remember, we're looking at the story from different angles, like that video replay of a football game. And John says Jesus was already there. He was already ministering there. As a matter of fact, he had just called Lazarus out of the grave, and Lazarus is now raised from the dead. And this is big stuff, folks. This is all over the CNN, as it were, of the day. And people everywhere know about it, and they're excited. They want to meet this Jesus. Who is this guy? Plus, it's Passover, or Passover is about to come. And so for Jerusalem, this is the time where a whole bunch of people come together. Estimates vary, but some people put the possible total population that swelled in that day during Passover around 1 million people. Can you imagine that? Tons and tons of people. And they're so excited. There's such a euphoria about it. There's such a, wow, Jesus is coming. This guy who's raised Lazarus. And we want to see Lazarus too. And so there's such a commotion. But then Jesus does something that's extraordinary. He tells to his disciples, go into the village next in front of you, which would be Bethpage. And there you're going to find a colt, a young donkey. Now, why is that significant? Even in this video and other stories, you see Jesus riding on a donkey. Well, donkeys were beasts of burden. They were there to carry the weight. But actually, Jesus comes on a young donkey. And I think it's important for a couple of reasons, which we're going to look at. But let me just say this to begin with. If a king is going to come into a town, if a king is going to arrive, he's going to arrive on the biggest, tallest horse. Because if you're a king, you come in to rule and reign on a horse. A horse shows that you're there to dominate. Our terminology, our closest terminology would be Air Force One. He shows up on Air Force One. It's how you're supposed to show up. Jesus doesn't do that at all. Later on, we read in Revelation 19 that when Jesus comes back, he's going to be on a white horse. Woo, that's going to be a day. Not only is it a horse, which is meant for war and for justice, as Revelation 19 tells us, it's a white horse, pure and holy. But now we read the story where Jesus is about to go into Jerusalem. Now, you have to understand, we see the whole story, but you have to understand from the point of view of the disciples, every time they've gone into Jerusalem with Jesus for these almost 3 years, it's a mess. Something bad happens, right? Earlier on, Jesus turns over the temple in John chapter 2, and the officials get really mad, right? He causes a scene. Other times, he's healing on the Sabbath, and he gets questioned, and the authorities come, and the Pharisees and the Sadducees are not happy. In other words, every time they show up in Jerusalem, something bad happens, and it's not a really cool place to go. So now Jesus is like, oh, we're going to go into Jerusalem. And I can just imagine the disciples kind of almost putting their head down going, oh, no, here we go again. Oh, what's going to happen this time? But now they're coming, and suddenly this throngs of people are coming out with palm branches, throwing their clothing down on the ground. We call that a red carpet treatment. And they're singing, and they're saying, Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Anybody here know what Hosanna means? See, we don't even know. I didn't even know. I have to admit it. I probably knew it at once, but I totally forgot. I'm like, what does the world mean? Usually we just think of praise. We're going to come back to it in just a moment. Give you a little teaser. Because there's something really interesting about that phrase. Let's go back to the text. Jesus tells him to get a coal. Now, Zechariah 9, chapter 9, verse 9 says that out of Jerusalem, or daughters of Jerusalem, or as John quotes, he actually adds the phrase, fear not. Rejoice greatly, daughters of Jerusalem. Shout. That's what the people are doing. Woohoo! Shout, daughters of Jerusalem. See, your king comes. You see, people knew the prophecies. Wow, Jesus is coming. Finally, the king is showing up. He's going to take over the Romans. He's going to get rid of all this unrighteousness. He's going to take care of the problems we're having. Yay! The king is coming. And look, coming in righteousness and victorious. But now watch. Lowly, riding on a donkey, on a colt, baby, young donkey, the foal of a donkey. Why is that there? Not only is Jesus fulfilling an ancient prophecy from Zechariah 9:9, I think it showed Jesus' intent, and nobody got it. Like so many things that happen in yours and my life, God is on the move, and he's doing stuff, and we don't see it. All we know is the here and now. And so many times when it doesn't happen the way we thought, so many times when it doesn't come together like we thought it would, we get so disappointed. You see, I think that's the lesson of Palm Sunday, but we're coming to that. Because there was such an expectation that all the people come out with their palm branches and singing and saying and shouting and, wow, finally, the king is here. See, they knew the scripture, I'm sure, but they forgot several key things. Why a donkey? Well, if you're going to come in as a kingly warrior, as a takeover, show of power, you're going to be on the horse I talked about. But if a king comes on a donkey, that's a sign of peace. Peace. And not only just a donkey, Jesus goes for the lowly of the lows. He goes for a young donkey, a colt. Now, I can imagine, I don't know if you've ever been around donkeys. They're not really that big anyway. Mules are a little bigger because they're a crossbreed, you know, with a horse, and of course horses are bigger. But if you get a baby donkey or a colt, it's really low to the ground. I can imagine, although this video doesn't show, but I can imagine that Jesus sat on that colt, and I bet his feet practically dragged on the ground because he was so low. What does that say about character? You see, that's his identity. What he's riding on is identity. He knows who he is. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. But they don't see it. What they see is what they want to see. You see, sometimes when we want to see something, we will make it work theologically. We'll make it work circumstantially. We will put all the things together and we'll say, this is God. And then when it doesn't happen, we don't know what to do. Sound like some recent politics for you? Sound like some recent disappointments? We put our hope in this person. I put my hope in this circumstance. I thought it was going to happen this way, and it didn't. But they don't know that yet, because at this point, it's big deal. Jesus is coming, the king. Hosanna, Hosanna. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You know where they're getting that from, by the way? It's called the Hallel. If you've ever been a part of a Seder, oftentimes it's read as part of Passover. It's Psalm 113 all the way through Psalm 118. And part of that Hallel, right at the very end of Psalm 118, is exactly what you hear the people say. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You know what Hosanna means? Save now. Hosa means save, na, the ending, now. Save now. That's significant. Because just like you and me, we want things to happen right now. Come on, God, I prayed the prayer. I need this job right now. I need the finances to turn around right now. You know that stimulus check? That was really awesome. But Lord, I need an answer right now. Save now. And when it doesn't happen that way, we get really disappointed. God, where were you? I'm so frustrated with you. And we don't know what to do. You see, when we want something from Jesus, it's easy to say, praise you, Lord. Glory to God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. When he needs to be something, that's a little different. Let's look at Luke 19. We'll put it up there on the screen. Luke 19, this is Luke's account. And remember, you got to remember something about the gospel writers. Although it's absolutely 100% inspired by the Holy Spirit, it is the Word of God. It doesn't just contain the Word of God. We firmly believe this is the Word of God. Right? Amen. But God used human writers to do it. And Mark is very concise. He's considered the one that goes fast through the Gospels. John is the relational one. He doesn't even describe any of Jesus' miracles. He's all about the relationships. He's all about the inner dialogue. That's why we get the story of right before this where Mary anoints Jesus' feet. It's only recorded in John because it's so significant what she does, those humble acts. Luke is the writer, right? He's the physician. He's got all the detail. So he actually has a lot more detail in this account. Luke does. So let's see what Luke says. And when Jesus had drawn near, he saw the city and he wept over it. See, God often has a different plan than what we see. He's weeping over Jerusalem, verse 42, saying, "Would you, even you," he's speaking to the city, "had known this day the things that made for peace." He's riding on a donkey of peace. If you had known it, this should have been your day, Jerusalem, for peace. But now they are hidden from your eyes. Verse 43. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children within. Whew. And they will not leave one stone upon another, because you did not know the time of your visitation. Jerusalem, you blew it. This could have been your day, but you blew it. Wow. See, as much as the crowds were shouting out, "Save us now! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Woo! Awesome! We got a king!" Jesus knew. And he weeps because they've missed it, because they were looking for what they wanted, not what they needed. You see, they wanted a king to throw over the government, get rid of the Roman rule, set them back right. What they needed was a savior. We know through various places in Scripture that this day was the 10th day of Nisan, not the car. It's actually the name of the Jewish month. The 10th day of Nisan, and Passover was coming. It was actually going to be that Friday, the 14th of Nisan. 4 more days. This is significant because when all this, woohoo, blessed be the name of the Lord stuff's going on, just 4 more days, things will radically change. You see, on that Friday when Passover would come, the greatest thing in the Jewish history, not only commemorating the Exodus and God delivering them, but the high priest would take the pure and spotless lamb and would bring it into the altar and would sacrifice that pure, blemishless, spotless lamb and would slaughter it at about more or less 3 o'clock in the afternoon of Passover before sundown. We're about to celebrate Good Friday this Friday. It's why we have Good Friday on a Friday and Easter on a Sunday, even though the calendar doesn't exactly match for this year with Passover. But on that Friday, when the high priest would be in the temple sacrificing that pure, spotless lamb, guess what else happened? On Friday at 3 o'clock on a lonely hill called Calvary. See, God's plan doesn't look like ours. And he was fulfilling the ultimate sacrificial lamb, the ultimate sacrifice that would take away all the other sacrifices to come. All they had was an atonement, which means to cover over. Christ now becomes not only our atonement cover over, but he takes away the sins of the world. That's what he was after. And he knows it. He's the only one who knows it. As you saw in the video and what's recorded in John, John says later on the disciples, after Jesus' death and resurrection, they went, wow, I should have had a V8. No, that's an old commercial. They went, wow, now I remember. That's what was going to happen. Jesus said it himself. The prophet Zechariah said it. Now we get it. But you know, when we're in the midst of it, we don't get it. We don't see it. Sometimes we need that multiple angles to get a view from back here, the bigger picture. You see, this, as I said, this is only the second time that all four gospel writers record an event, the first being the feeding of the 5,000. Why Palm Sunday? Because it's a big deal. Because God is doing something, and he's changing and about to change the atmosphere. As a matter of fact, my Bible says it's called the triumphant entry. You probably could call this the untriumphant entry. Not because it wasn't triumphant at the moment. It's because in 4 days later, things would radically change. Jesus is weeping over Jerusalem. They're singing, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Save now. We have a king. 4 days later, we have no king but Caesar. Today, they're saying, Jesus, save us. Save us now. 4 days later, crucify him. Today, they're saying, we need Jesus. We need the king. 4 days later, we don't need him. Give us Barabbas instead. God, our fickle hearts. My fickle heart. Oh, when it's going good, I'm all on board. When things don't go the way I want them to, it isn't God who's changed. It's I've lost my perspective. I can't see. I can't see like he does. I can't see what he's doing. You see, for him, I think it was an untriumphal entry. Could have been their day. But it wasn't. I'm sure he enjoyed the praise. If I was one of the disciples, I would be like hog heaven. Remember, all the other times they had gone to Jerusalem, bad things happened. Now they're finally going there. And then I can just imagine the disciples looking around at this crowd going, whoa, this is really different. Like, we hardly even were noticed last time other than some crowds because Jesus did miracles. Now everybody's praising him. He's coming in as king. Woo! We're finally doing this thing. Yeah. Come on. I'm on Jesus' team. I'm Team Jesus. I got the sweatshirt now. Right? I got the t-shirt. I'm on Team Jesus' side. Right? Woo! Things are finally happening. 4 days later, after the Passover supper, out in the garden, Peter around the fireplace, I don't know him. Jesus, what Jesus? Who? 4 days later, God, save us from our fickle hearts. Save us from the ways that we don't see you. A few more things. What they missed, even though they had said it, thousands of times. As I said, the Hallel, Psalm 113 through Psalm 118, they read over and over every Passover, if not other celebrations. They missed the one key phrase. Psalm 118, verse 22 through 23 says, the stone that the builder rejected became the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. Lord's doing. And it marvels in our eyes. This is the Lord's doing. What's that mean? You see, they sing right after this verse, as blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It actually almost ends Psalm 118. They're so used to this passage, that's why they're saying this at Palm Sunday. But they missed the cornerstone. You see, what they wanted was a ruling king. What they needed was a savior. What we want is God to answer my prayers right now. What we need is up to him. Maybe it's a delay. Maybe it's because of character building. We so easily interpret it as punishment. What did I do, God, to deserve this? What bad sin have I done? And we forget that he's removed our sins. He's taken them as far as east as from the west. Why do we beat ourselves up? I certainly do. For those who know what Dan Mattis is going through, can't even imagine. About to face a year of unprecedented stuff. But I know Dan. He'd be the first one to say, blessed is the name of the Lord. My heart will surely say, as the songwriter says, blessed be the name of the Lord. Moving on to Mark 13. There's so much in this passage, but Mark 13, they finally go into the temple, and we know from both this passage in Mark and other places that Jesus clears out the temple once again. He already did it way early in his ministry. He has to go back into the temple and clear it out again. I don't know if you ever knew that, saw that. But Jesus has to drive out the money changers. This time, big time. Because all these people, literally thousands and thousands of people, are coming there. And in the temple courts are a whole bunch of boxes of doves and pigeons and money changers. And why is that? Well, because they had to offer a sacrifice. And even the poorest of poor had to come up with at least a money for two pigeons to be sacrificed. And the currency required by the Old Testament was a Jewish shekel. The currency of the day was a Roman coin. So they had to have money changers. Call it the 4X of the day. And there was a huge profit margin there that it was actually taxing the poor because the other guys wanted to get rich. And Jesus, again, has to clear out the temple and says, no, this is my Father's house, a house of prayer. We move into Mark 13, and the disciples come outside, and stick on that next picture, if you would, David. Here's what the replica of the temple of Herod would look like. Now, it's a little hard to tell because it's a replica, but if you look at the bottom right-hand side, this is a huge door at the bottom with those little staircases. That temple would have been like the monstrous building of all time. It'd be like going to, I don't know if you know this, but the largest building in the world is in Dubai, in the United Arab Emirates. It'd be like going to that building and looking up at it and going, wow! Or taking a glass elevator up it and getting the view. It would to see Herod's temple would have just been like, wow! Especially if you'd never been there before, if it was your first Passover in Jerusalem. And they come out of the temple after cleansing it, and the disciples kind of, I think, filling in space, honestly. What do you say to Jesus after all that happened? So they walk out of the temple and look in at the building going, wow, this is a really cool building, modern-day translation. This is a really cool building, Jesus. And then Jesus says something really interesting. He says, not one stone will be left upon it. He's prophesying. He said the same thing when he prayed in what we looked at in Luke 19. He's prophesying. Literally, if this is about 30 AD, depends on your calendar, we know that historians tell us that 70 AD, Jerusalem is leveled to the ground. Historians said the devastation was so great that there was not even one stone upon another. Jesus is basically saying in 40 years, this place is going to look totally different. Way past their lifetime. See, God's timing isn't our timing. And then he says, but there's going to be a whole bunch of stuff that happens. Go and put that one, next one up, David. There's going to be a whole bunch of stuff that happens. There's going to be famine. Nations will rise up against nations. Brothers are going to kill brothers. People are going to hate you on account of my name. He's talking about the end times here. Now, we don't even have time to go into that, but if I was a disciple, I'd be scratching my head going, wait a minute. They're just praising you a day or two ago. We finally got this king that's going to rule and reign and do away with the Romans, and you're talking this, Jesus? What do you mean? People are going to hate us. We're on the top of our game right now. I got Team Jesus on my t-shirt. Wars? Famines? People are going to hate me? They're going to persecute me? What are you talking about, Jesus? Right? Are you cray-cray or what? It's because he sees a picture we don't see. What they needed was a Savior, and they missed their day. They missed their appointed time. They missed what God had for them. One last slide from John 16. In John 16, Jesus says this, which is so profound in the context of what I've just said. I have said these things to you that in me you might have peace. Isn't that what he came to do? In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart. Be of good cheer. It's our good Be of Good Cheer series here in Mark. Take heart, for I have overcome the world. I've overcome the world. Jesus had to tell him, I've got it in control. I know what I'm doing. I know the beginning from the end. I think probably every single one of us believe that up here theologically. It's down here when stuff doesn't happen the way we thought. Right? Can you imagine being Friday, the crucifixion? Being one of the disciples, being one of the crowds. Instead of praising him, now it's crucify him. Instead of being one of the disciples going, we're on Team Jesus, things are finally happening, yahoo. Now we're like, wait a minute. This is not how I thought it was going to go. God, are you really in control? Philip Yancey, in his book, Disappointed with God, asks three questions. He says that these are the three questions we dare not ask out loud sometimes. God, are you unjust? Are you really in control? Do you really love me? Those are the questions that come up when things don't go the way we wanted, when it didn't happen the way we thought. Because like the disciples, like the crowd, we only can see the here and now. You know what we really need? We need that proverbial step back, and we need to say, Lord, I trust you, even when I can't see it. I put my trust in you, even though it doesn't look at anything what I thought it was going to be. My heart will truly say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Let's pray. God, I thank you for this revelation from Palm Sunday. That, Lord, you had a plan. It's never changed. Nothing takes you by surprise. You know the begin from the end, from the beginning from the end. You know everything about us. You hold all things. All things that are made, you hold and keep them together. God, you are God, and we are not. Forgive us, Lord, for our fickle hearts, for one day we praise you, and the next, it's so easy to grumble and question. Lord, I don't think you mind our questioning. I think you're saddened when we no longer believe. God, forgive us for our unbelief. As we enter into this Passion Week, this Holy Week, Lord, we know it doesn't end on Friday. Sunday's a-coming. Sunday's a-coming. Your resurrection, not just from the dead, but your resurrection of your purposes and plans for my life and my fellow Grace Point congregation, Lord. Your purposes and plan are there. And you are the God of resurrection. You are the God of new beginnings. You are the God who holds all things. And Lord, we put our heart and our trust in you. Lord, thank you for that revelation. Thank you for your heart. So Jesus, we just say we love you. Amen. As we gather around the tables this morning to just have a short time of discussion and prayer, maybe just pray for one another, for these places where we're disappointed, where things didn't go the way we thought. And just ask the Lord for healing. Maybe there's some disappointment you need to speak out loud, some place where you're struggling still. God, I don't see the bigger picture. Let it just be a nice time of ministry right around the table in the next 10 minutes or so. Okay?